Thank you, Mindy. And also thanks for having me. So Regine, who said to me, Vera, talk about the science you were doing. But actually, about the first two talks we heard, I had so many ideas for what I could answer, and now actually you should have planned 2 or 3 days for fungi, because actually what you all have to be aware of is they can be our friends and foes. So there are about 5 million fungi out there on Earth, and we know a couple of thousands. We are close to plus sequenced 1,000 genomes. And from the fungi we know, many of them actually are pathogens. 7 billion people live on Earth, 1 billion suffer from fungal infection. 2 million die every year. This is more, these are more people than who die from malaria or tuberculosis. 15-20% of our worldwide crop production gets lost due to fungal pathogens. With this amount, you could feed 600 million people a year, just the complete North American continent. On the other hand, fungi, they offer us solutions how we can transit from a petroleum-based world towards a sustainable future. So please have this in mind, and also don't look at them only at the kind of romantic view. They grow on us. So only if you have an intact immune system, then you're protected. If not, we're just nice food for fungi. But now coming to my talk, fungal biotechnology. So I'm a biotechnologist by training. And I want to talk about what we do with fungi, and I want to put this in a little bit bigger context, also the historical context. So what is biotechnology, what is fungal biotechnology? What's the state of your art, and what the future of fungal biotechnology is? And I put in brackets, and what fungi do with us, if there's 1 or 2 minutes time, I just leave that yet. They do a lot with us. Mm-hmm. The birth of biotechnology is exactly 100 years ago that a chemist, James Curry, found out that a mold, Aspergillus niger, is producing a lot of citric acid, which lowers the pH of the bean. And since 100 years, we are using that fungus, Aspergillus niger, to produce citric acid. And you can find it now everywhere, in food, stuff, in different things. So this is the birth, so Aspergillus niger is, let's say, the pioneer of modern biotechnology. And since then, many other fungi have been introduced. Maya mentioned Aspergillus oryzae, the one used in China for making sake and so on. You might have heard of Penicillium crassosinum, this producer of penicillin. So a dozen, can even be 20 or 30 different fungi are used in industry to produce a couple or a huge set of compounds which are used in food and in feed and pharma industry and in chemical industry in a fuel industry, and basically the way how we cultivate them is in these large bioreactors. So these are 100, 200, 300,000 liters of medium, and there we stir the fungi, and they produce a lot of enzymes that produce a lot of organic acids or just drugs. Oh, sorry. Oops. Oh, now. Full screen. No, I just pressed the wrong button. Doesn't matter. Okay. Last year, we and other European scientists also, let's say the worldwide biotech industry, which is involved in fungal science and fungal biotechnology, we had a look how the fungal biotechnology might look in 10 or 20 years, and what kind of technologies do we need to allow the transition from a petroleum-based world towards a sustainable world. And what we said and all concluded there, synthetic biology is a tool which helps us to reprogram fungi so that they make much faster, much more of the products we want to have. So what is synthetic biology? Actually, the era of synthetic biology started about 10 years ago, and the common definition of synthetic biology is that it's the design and construction of new biological parts, devices, and systems for useful purposes. Useful purposes means new drugs, new proteins, whatever. But it's also the redesign of existing natural biological systems for useful purposes. And one of the pioneers in synthetic biology, George Church, he's from Harvard, once said, a living organism, after all, is a ready-made, prefabricated production system that, like a computer, is governed by a program, its genome. And by making small changes in their genetic software, a bioengineer, basically us, can affect big changes in the output. So currently what we're doing in synthetic biology, we reprogram in a rational way living organisms. The era of synthetic biology in fungi started 3-4 years ago. And this is the cover of a special issue which was published last year, where it more or less discussed the milestones in synthetic biology in fungi. And the reason why we are also interested in filamentous fungi, or fungi in general, is we all hope that, or we know when we sequence the genome, that there are many new compounds hidden there. They are not produced, but we know that the genome tells us, well, you might find there another penicillin or another compound which is an antibiotic or which is a cholesterol lowering agent or whatever. And in that issue, we have sort of showcased what are the current bioinformatic and genetic tools to predict, discover, and encrypt gene clusters, which could produce these kind of new compounds, drugs. And we have discussed a couple of other issues there. And the reason why the fungal community, the fungal research community, the applied fungal research community is so interested in studying fungi is there are actually two key drivers. The first key driver is we have the problem of multi-resistant bacteria, and the diagram which you show here is gives you the number of companies being active in 1985 in producing new antibiotics, and this number is 18 and now dropped down to 4 companies, and the graphs here show you this is the rise of multi-resistant bacteria. And there is a big hope that we find something in these fungal genomes which could be the penicillin 2.0 of the new century. Because most of those fungi, those bacteria, are resistant to penicillin. And you might have wondered about the cover figure of this special issue. I was very happy that I could, Alexandra Daisy Ginsberg, perhaps you might have heard of her, that she allowed us to feature one of her work on this cover page. This is a kind of fictitious patent for a synthetic device to detect and treat a plant disease which is caused by a fungus. And she has developed a fungus-like device which is able to detect, well, there is a pathogen, and then injects a toxin into the pathogen. And basically, with this fictitious patent, she more or less hits the nail on the giant's faced head, is what I said. So fungi can be both, friends and foes. So it's really cool. I love her. Okay, so what's the state of the art in synthetic biology in Aspergillus niger? So it's the fungus we are working here in Berlin with. And we know since a couple of years that it produces a lot of proteins which are used in different industries as enzymes. We know that it produces citric acid, I mentioned this already. But what we are interested in, we want to reprogram that fungus that it produces also small molecule drugs. The compound you see here, this is penicillin, for example. Actually, the interest in synthetic biology is to design a platform organism which can produce all of these varieties so that you just only cultivate this single organism and not use 20 different for 20 different compounds. This would make many things more efficient. So what's the state of the art? What I want to do is just to discuss in the next slides, and perhaps I might lose some of you. We will see. What do we want to do, and what can we do, and how much we have learned, and I want to illustrate this with 3 examples, how to make gene switches, how to do a genome, how can we synthesize small molecules in gram scale, how to redesign these drugs to get better new drugs, new to nature compounds, and how important it is to merge synthetic and systems biology. And I'll give you a definition of what systems biology is later. So synthetic gene switch is how to turn a gene on. So basically what you see here is, we call this expression cassette. This contains all the information you need to express a gene of interest into a protein, to make from a gene a protein. And this expression cassette contains different compounds, and we have taken them from different organisms. Asparagus nitidans, Escherichia coli, it's a bacterium, another fungus, another fungus, another fungus, and a virus. And we have put them all together as such that there's a so-called transcription factor produced, which can only bind, or which can only activate this gene of interest if we also add the compound doxycycline. If this doxycycline, if this compound is not there, the gene is not expressed. And we have shown this recently, or we have studied, and then we have also published this, that we can really produce a high amount of a drug, of a compound, which is already marketed by the pharma industry. It's called NATB, and this is used to treat bacterial throat infections. And what we have done, we just took the whole expression cassette and put the encoding gene in it, and this is from another fungus, Fusarium oxysporum. So basically all synthetic DNA brought into Aspergillus niger. And don't be irritated, the only thing what I want to say here is we need to feed with two different compounds, precursors. The enzyme itself is a modular enzyme, and it contains of two modules. And what it's doing, it takes these two precursors, makes D-peptidol, forget it immediately, takes three out of those, makes an hexa ring, makes four out of those, makes an octa ring. Octadecipeptide. Just forget it. Okay, so these are multimodular enzymes. And in life science, and especially in biotechnology, you work you work in a team, you have many, many people, and these were three PhD students who were involved in the project, and actually what they did, they transformed this gene switch expressing this N18 synthetase into Aspergillus niger, cultivated then, so selected transformers, cultivated for a couple of days, and obtained in a shake flask format, 1 gram per liter almost, 4.5 gram when we go for a stirred tank reactor, and when we go for another system, which we call wave mixed reactor, 8 gram per liter. So within a couple of days, we can produce 40 gram in 3 days. And 20% of the biomass, of the total biomass, is this drug. Is this worth something? 40 gram sounds much. But if we were Sigma, and Sigma is a company in life science who is selling these pure compounds, we would sell 1 milligram for 140 euro, making, wow, we would make 5 million euros in 3 days. We are, of course, not doing this. We are not selling this. But this was a proof of concept, and this was appreciated by the community. There's a proof of concept that Niger can be reprogrammed also as a producer for pharmaceuticals, because you can produce in high amounts the compounds you want to have. Is there any room left for further innovation? Yeah, so when we worked with the chemical department together, and it's perhaps also not so easy to understand this, but basically this was the enzyme I've been talking about, and this is the one module, and this is the other module, and they accept these different precursors. And you can find similar enzymes in other fungi. So this is from a Fusarium, this is from a Bovaria, different fungi. And they have their different enzymes, and they make other compounds. And in synthetic biology, what you can do now is just, we simply swap the modules. We just bring from one enzyme, module one, put it together with module two from the other enzyme. And by this, we generate completely new compounds. We call them mutant nature. And they can have, not all of them, but they can have a biological activity. And Charlotte, she even went a step further. Again, we have these three enzymes. This way here, module one, module two. She found out that this last domain within this module two defines the ring size. And she also managed to obtain new drugs. Enyatin was a hexa, now it's an octa molecule. Bovaritin was a hexa, now it's an octa molecule. And the good thing is that these compounds are tenfold higher active against human parasites than the available ones. And this shows you the potential, what we can achieve in synthetic biology and why we're doing this, to make better drugs, new drugs. So to put this together, you can reprogram filamentous fungi, especially in Niger, so this is the one we are working with, up to reprogram so that you can produce gram per liter scale amounts of a compound of your interest, and this is done with these synthetic gene switches. Because this is such a high productivity, we can re-engineer the enzymes, we can let them do different things, and we even end up with new compounds, which are, have a better stability, bioactivity, and so on. Is this as far as we can go? No, I would say, because if you merge synthetic biology with so-called systems biology, meaning we also look at Niger and its behavior as a system, we can even improve productivity. The right picture, what you see here, reflects the gene network of Aspergillus niger. Aspergillus niger has 14,000 genes, and under each and every growth conditions, the fungus makes a decision which of those genes do I need now that they become expressed to protein, to let me grow, to let me divide, to let me produce whatever. What Paul did was a so-called meta-analysis of transcriptome data for 155 different cultivation conditions, which we obtained in our lab or other labs, and which were basically available in the community. Transcriptome data are data which tell you which of those 14,000 genes are on or off under those different 150 growth conditions. And he made these gene networks, and I'm not going to tell you about these networks because this will bring me far away from this, what I want to tell, and also the time is not sufficient. But we can use this information to identify chromosomal regions in Aspergillus niger which have a high or low activity, so where genes are highly or lowly expressed. What you see here are these eight panels reflect the eight chromosomes of Aspergillus niger. The humans have 23, Aspergillus has 8, sufficient. And the color code says you very low and low expression of a gene is whitish and yellowish, for example here. And green is medium expressed, and red are the regions which have a very high gene activity. And we thought, when we now bring our gene switch into a region which has a high transcriptional activity or a low transcriptional activity, we can also modify the activity of the whole gene switch. This is the traditional region where we and other groups worldwide bring in genes when we want to transform Aspergillus niger. This is the Purgi locus, and you immediately see, well, it is a medium, whatever, medium low expressed locus in chromosome 3. In chromosome 7, we have identified some regions, two are white, so lowly expressed, two are red, so they are highly expressed, and we thought, let's take those three regions, integrate our TET-on switch, and then see whether we get higher in red activity compared to green, or lower, And a bachelor student, Björn, he actually did this experiment, and it turned out what we have predicted, or what the transcriptomic meta-analysis that the data predicted. And again, just it's not important to understand the axis. The idea is here is the gene activity over the time, over the cultivation time. In green is the activity of this expression cassette at this locus. In red is the activity when we integrate it in that locus. And in white, when we integrate the same cassette in this locus. So meaning with the same gene switch and having a information where to put it in the genome, we can now define the time of induction of expression and also the absolute value, which is also cool, and which brings me to a very enthusiastic, which makes all of us very enthusiastic, because we think we are now moving from descriptive biology to kind of predictive. Still, we are at the very beginning, but when putting synthetic biology together with systems biology information, we can do so. You remember this illustration and ask a couple of questions, and I hope some of which I have answered, okay, very briefly. And I hope you could have also seen that how important it is, the partnership of synthetic and systems biology. About the things I talked to you, and taking also in mind the statements of Richard Feynman, one of the most famous physicists, what I cannot create, I do not understand. And George Church, who is a synthetic biologist, he said, what we can create, we don't necessarily understand. My group's conclusion would be understanding the system enables us to create. So this is what we do with fungi. But, yeah, 1 minute, super, 2 minutes, perfect. And what fungi do with us? Basically, they inspire us. We had already the first talks, and they were so lovely and beautiful, and I could see really in the eyes of Sasha and Miriam, so they're really excited by fungi. And there are many more. And we have last year published a little review, Corrado and me, from my group, The Beauty and the Morbid Fungi as Source of Inspiration in Contemporary Art. And there we have specifically looked for artists which bring this a step further, their artistic view, in terms of can they make something out of it which brings us humans a new technology, a new product, a new way of looking at. The left figure is from Aniela. She's a Dutch artist, and she makes these breathtaking dresses out of mushrooms. She takes the mushroom mycelium. J. Rim Lee took the seeing fungi as decomposers, and understood that fungi actually very quickly decompose materials and can detoxify. What she was thinking about, and she founded her company 2 years ago, Coeo is called, a death suit. So you can buy in the States a death suit, costs you €2,000. Then you become not embalmed or whatever, there is no coffin, just this infinity mushroom suit. And then you can just leave the planet in jointly with the mushrooms. But J. Rim, she studied also bioremediation, so basically she became a biotechnologist, an artistic biotechnologist. And there are two other companies I want to mention here. Ecovative. They produce these boxes, not out of plastic, this is mushroom material. Another company, MicroWorks, they make mushrooms or transform them into new materials which look like, which feel like leather. So they are now already on the American market. The forecast says within 2 years or so, you can also buy them in Europe. So they are fungi art champions. So they, because of their ability that they basically can grow on everything, because their ability that they can produce almost everything, they offer a lot of solutions for the future, for the human welfare and mankind. So they are champions. Thank you.
Yeah, great research. And could you comment a bit, I think it's something that people is often on the mind, about ways, strategies that people use to maybe keep these modified organisms in the lab. You know, like obviously you need a specific compound to reduce your expression, right? But.
What do you mean with keeping them in the lab?
I mean things like using natural amino acids, for example, so they can only grow when you feed them, you know, their special media, that sort of thing.
basically, of course, all the work we are doing, we do them in safety labs. So there is an every 2 years, or actually every year or every 2 years at latest, we become controlled as every lab which is working with GMOs worldwide. To make sure that we fulfill all the safety rules. If we would not treat them well, they of course could escape the lab. So you do not need to feed special amino acids for them. They also use in biotechnology to grow on plant waste materials. So that's the beauty about those fungi, because they can grow on everything. You can just offer them every food.
I meant more in the sense of escaping, I think legitimate concern about introducing these.
So this is a special concern in bacteria synthetic biology, and yes, the strains which are used there, they have, let's say, a specific firewalls, so that they cannot grow outside. But the fungi we are working with here, which we have also modified, these are not pathogenic, which is different from the E. coli. E. coli can be pathogenic. So all they go back to natural compounds, whereas so basically the FDA, the American Food and Drug Administration, has said all microorganisms which humankind has shown that it can safely work with them before 1958. They get the so-called GRAS status, generally regarded as safe or generally recognized as safe. For those which are introduced later, you have to prove that they are not harmful for man or environment. And this is the reason why many also stick to Aspergillus niger and now say, well, let's reprogram that one, because this is a safe fungus.
Yeah? Questions?
Just a very obvious question, probably going back to this first citation of George Church that you were mentioning, where he uses this machine analogy, basically describing these organisms as some kind of black boxes with input and output. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious, is that something that you can really subscribe to, or is it close to your experience when you work on this on a daily material base, or maybe do you have some other experiences? How is it related as well to the systems approach that you were mentioning? And then I'm kind of afraid the question is fuzzy, because of course it depends on what we talk about as a machine, how we define machine, because they can also be fuzzy and unpredictable, so it's kind of unclear. But
so the founding community of synthetic biology was a community where mainly engineers are working, and they have this view of a machine. And the idea was, we know these genomes, we know there are a lot of sequences which obviously have no function. We can delete them, we can make minimal genomes out of them, and then we just plug in these expression cassettes which we want to have, and then we produce ethanol or drug or whatever. The reality is, and most of it started with bacteria system and yeast systems, and the most complicated are the filamentous fungal systems. The reality is that we are far away from understanding how a cell works, even a bacteria cell. The smallest bacterium has about 600 genes, mycoplasma. It's actually a pathogen, human pathogen. And Craig Venter, you might have heard him, he wanted to reduce the number of genes further, but then they realized, based on classical analysis, one would say, 300 you can just leave out, it's not lethal. But when you end up with 300, it's not living. So it's the system is complex, and the reason why it's complex, it's not complicated, it's complex. Because each and every gene, so a gene is transcribed into a messenger RNA, in a protein, this makes a metabolite. And all of these have a feedback somehow, a feedback loop, and say make more or less of this. So the system is not linear, but this is the way how we see it so far. We understand more and more there are different levels of regulation. The sense of nature, the sense of a living system is to survive, to grow as fast as possible and to survive. The rest doesn't care. And for this, it has introduced so many bypass pathways. Yeah. So if one is not working, I go another way. If that one is working, I have to go, oh, I have, yeah. So there are many backup systems in the cell, and we are far away from understanding them. But these synthetic biologists are, let's say, sort of radical in their view. Let's give it a try. And if we have understood it, or if, let's say, if you can make a purely synthetic cell, then we have understood the system. So it's what Miriam also said. So there's a kind of mystery always. So the more you look, the more you zoom in, the more mysteries pops up. Then you start to understand that one, and then there's more, so it's still, that's cool. I mean, they will keep us busy for the next 100 years. Yeah.
Thanks, Vera, that was very interesting. I work with yeast, and I'm really interested in evolutionary theory and the separation between humans and nature in evolutionary theory, and curious as to how you might look at how synthetic biology could contribute or is affected by evolutionary theory. And I'm also wondering what you see as the distinction between synthetic biology and genetic engineering. Is it just a rebranding? And finally, how does the fungus deal with the manipulation? Does it kick it out, or are there one particular manipulations it doesn't like?
So starting with the end, so there's a certain flexibility. So if sometimes we really have the feeling we have to persuade the fungus to produce a certain protein, but it doesn't like it because it has some detrimental effect in the cells, perhaps because it interacts with something, which then has a second, a third, whatever consequence. I would not say that humans have sort of separated from the evolution. That they're still part of it, and synthetic biology, which is made out of humans, could yield, this is the way how Alexander Daisy Ginsberg sees this, to a new kingdom, the synthetic kingdom. Now we have in the domain of eukaryotes, we have many kingdoms, and this could be a new kingdom. Remember that humans are not the first species on Earth which completely changed the way how the Earth looked like. Remember 3 billion years ago, the cyanobacteria came up. Before that, there was just no oxygen on Earth. There were many, many, many organisms, and they were happily growing wherever on land and in water. But then the cyanobacteria came up and they said, well, now let's produce oxygen. And oxygen is toxic. Oxygen is the reason why sooner or later we all have to die. And they killed all organisms. There is no good or bad. It's just there is a selection advantage, and obviously now we have a selective advantage. And luckily, many of us understand that the resources on Earth are limited. Let's try to use them in a much, much better way. Let's go away from this classical economy towards a circular economy where fungi play an important role, because they use waste products out of crop industry, of whatever animal industry, and they can be used then to produce insulin, penicillin, ethanol, and so on. So there is also, as I said at the beginning, so I think we should not look at these organisms in a romantic or way. The only thing what an organism wants is to survive. And there's a delicate balance between organisms on Earth, on our skin, in the water. Many of them form symbiosis, others are pathogens. If you wouldn't have any immune system, we would die of candida. Yeah, you work with yeast. But candida also belongs to our normal microflora.
we have different filamentous fungi here in this, I don't know how this is called, even not in German, but anyway, yeah, you understand? At the heel, there are different ones in the everywhere. Also, the bacteria, so that's really cool. There's a specific microflora. Those who are living here, they see this like a rainforest because it's more wetty, and it here's like a desert, it's more dry. Mm-hmm. And even more wetty, of course, it's, yeah, you know, weather wetty. So there's a, we consist out of 10 to the power of 12 cells, and 10 to the power of 14 organisms live on us. Man or human being is not a singular entity. We call it meta-organism. And there is always this friendship, symbiosis, pathogenic thing going on. This is also the case on the, everywhere, on a plant, in a plant. There are plants there which can produce a certain compound. They can only produce this compound because there is a fungus in the plant, as in the symbiont, and they can only make this if in the fungus is a virus. So it was a cool publication by Science, a virus and a fungus in a plant. And this all together works.
All right, so shall we start the panel discussion? We can continue on this track. Thank you all, that was great. I really enjoyed that. I think that last note you ended on about economies. It makes me think, I don't know if any of you have read this book, The Mushroom at the End of the World by Anna Zink. So I recommend it. It's this kind of look at a post-capitalist economy and how specifically focusing on these wild forage mushroom markets and these mushrooms that are gathered in Finland or in Oregon and then sold to East Asia, and this kind of delocalized, decentralized kind of economies, and seeing this as being opposed to the monoculture you mentioned. You know, we have one species that we want to grow, and we want to, you know, till the whole field, kill everything, and grow this one thing and harvest it, which I think is a very linear kind of classical thing. So anyway, I kind of see that threatened.
Very important aspect. So you all know Robert Koch, right? In 150 years ago, he basically managed to cultivate microorganisms in a petri dish of our. And he was the one who said we need to grow an accentic culture, some pure culture. And this basically ended up nowadays that we know a lot of, about microorganisms and fungi, but we can cultivate them only 1% out of them in the lab. So 99% are, we call them microbial dark matter, like we have this dark matter out in space there. And we have now to move, and therefore your work is very much interesting of your artists. We have to look at these species as co-cultures which communicate with different organisms. The view how we have on them, this is a toxin, amanitin is a toxin. It is an anthropocentric view, it's for us a toxin. But for the fungus, it might be a selective advantage under certain growth conditions when it beats whatever bacterium. Yeah. So this is now it's a very important state in microbiology, and I encourage all artists just to be active in this field, because now we transit there must be a paradigm shift. We should go away from this accentic cultures, which we need, of course, in biotech, when we cultivate in our scale, but to understand how biological systems work and function and communicate, we need to look at them as a consortium.
I just want to mention one of the things that I noticed through the whole history and everything we were focusing on one subject, on one human, one cell, on one species, and now all of a sudden everything opened up, and basically what is more important for me now is like relations and how these relations work, like even if they're pathogenic or symbiotic or any way. So it's like go from from the solid to more flowing.
But there is no per se relation. So as I said, so it can be symbiosis, but within second, one partner can become a pathogen. Because it's always is a marketplace, so you give me glucose, I give you phosphate, so it's an antagonizer. But if it doesn't work, then it can become a pathogen.
So I remember that you said that maybe at the beginning when you were introducing, so is it 50-50? I think symbiosis only works when the cells work at once. So this is the right definition.
Seems like that breaks some fundamental law of physics. But all right, I think we had a question in the back. You still have anything?
Hi there.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is for Professor Mayer. Thank you very much for the inspiring talk. I follow the publications of your lab. Congratulations on last year's paper. It raised some eyebrows in the scientific community, but it definitely opened space for collaboration with art. Along those lines, two questions. One is, do you have any artists working with you at the moment? And the second, on the grounds of predictive biology and the transcriptomics that you show there, what will be the space for collaboration with artists or designers in the coming years, maybe in your lab? Thanks.
So I have a few students from here in Berlin, from the UDK, who just come and ask, can we do some work in your lab? And I say, yes, you can. And then we show them how to cultivate fungi. There was recently a nice masterpiece. So most of them really, they're designers and they come from the perspective, let's use them as, let's try to make bio-based materials using fungi. With the art laboratory, we are about to plan a 5-year, and if we get it granted, perhaps this can even be a longer collaboration where we think about artists in residence, and I would immediately apply for scientists in residence. Being a classical scientist, and I am a classical scientist, and I have only one week a year where I just do art. So basically, you wouldn't call it art. It's just I do something, and it's kind of mental yoga for me, just to not think. I lost my train of thought. What about the transcriptomics? I think it's the networks, because these are networks. This is again something which you perceive differently. So what I'm always happy is that I see that your perspectives are different than our ones. So when I see a micro area, I look at it completely different. And when talking with artists, understanding how they see it, that's amazing. Working with fungi helps you also to see that fungi have also a viewpoint, so they're not blind. They also have photoreceptors. They know where it's dark or where there's light. They know where to go, not because they have eyes, but they have receptors telling them, so taxis, chemotaxis. They can sense gradients in hydrogen, in water, in chemicals, and so on and so on. So they're not blind at all. And changing these perspectives, artists are very good in, because they have a kind of naive is the wrong way, but they have a kind of unconstrained view on things, especially when they see it the first time. And there I always see that something can emerge new from it. When I talk to other scientists, many scientists I know are interested in art and know other artists. Invite them. Netherlands is very strong in it, Utrecht, so this was the example from Angela Reuting, Microtex. Probably, for those of you who are considering working with
microorganisms, or could also be plants or something, just send an email to a scientist from which you think that this might be a good person. And I would say many of those will answer, well, why not? Because this is another way of appreciation we get. Usually the appreciation we get in science is your proposal was not granted, the publication was not accepted. We are now in the same stage, I would say, like you artists are, or architects, which I know, so only 10% of our proposals make it. 9 proposals you just write for. And that's, so then finding someone who appreciates the work we are doing, that's really cool, so go for
it. Although I don't think compared to artists, we can't complain about funding, so.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Yeah, in the back.
Yes, I have a more political and ethical question, because I'm a social scientist, so I don't really understand scientific biology, but I read an article about the possibility to create new life forms, to create new animals, so that we have never had, that wouldn't be come from evolution. So my question is, should we do everything we can do? Or because I know a lot of people that don't want that. That say there must be a regulation from politics, and so it's for me it's a bit too much harmony here. So my question is, yeah, really, I don't like that. And so my question is, where's the point? I think about xenotransplantation and all these things. Where's the point we say we stop? We don't want that. So that's my question.
So, yeah, as far as I know, hundreds of species die out every day. No one flinches an eye. So, and also thousands of new life forms are being created, actually. So with genetic engineering, well, with every seed comes a new life. So where do we say the boundaries? What is, because we have not really mastered the art of making life. What actually synthetic biologists do, they take a gene from another organism and transfer it, or maybe make some small changes if they are really lucky to do some computational prediction, which modification will do something. We are really clueless. So we are not really creating life, we are mixing it up. Which I don't see as a big problem, personally.
Basically, mixing up different life forms that this mankind has done since decades, even 100 years. So the crossing of different plants and mutating them with UV or with a mutagen, and then looking for do they make now more or whatever seeds. There also nobody's asking why they're doing it. So you just mutagenize. Synthetic biology is a way to rationally do this. This was the question I forgot to answer. So there's a difference between genetic engineering and synthetic biology. You know what you are doing. And I hope I could give you the example of this tetonsis in the gene switch. So we basically now know where we have to put it in the genome, and we know the consequences out of it. Synthetic biology is a way to do it is a way to modify organisms, and we do this since 50 years, in a rational way. And yes, you are absolutely right. Not everything which could be done should be done, and scientists are very well aware of this and very conscious. So that if you go to a synthetic biology conference, there are always sessions, and there are these plenary speakers who talk about ethics, about regulations. The industry which is involved in that field, they have specific regulations to make sure that no one is doing kind of malware or whatever. So the community, I would say, has learned from the GMO discussions which started in the 80s, and now is more consciousness doing the work, and also like me now, or you going out to conferences like these and telling about the work we are doing, and with contact to artists, to the general public, we also then learn what the fears are. Because yes, you're absolutely right, we were sort of, we're also kids. Scientists are also kids. They want to do something new, they want to try something new, they're just, it's playing around. And of course, we need these kind of reflections with others to understand and to see, well, is this good what we're doing? So your question is absolutely right.
Sasha, about you mentioned walking through the forest and kind of feeling the mycorrhizal and the networks and this natural environment. Do you ever feel conflicted bringing that into a very controlled environment? Or in a sense, you have to rely on the ones that we can control, right? Is there ever any conflict in your mind when you do that?
Actually not. Because I think I'm bringing something to the gallery space or to workshop or whatever that I do to show to the others what I found, what I saw, how I see it, and so they can do something with it and go from that. So it's just, like you said, we're kids, we bring something in, let's play, let's see how to do it. So I don't have it.
Questions? Tarsha, thank you.
A question first and then maybe a comment. So I'm curious as to how we as scientists, artists, scholars think about institutional ethics and institutional frameworks and how we navigate those and how we distinguish species according to those, because fungi are not considered within the institutional ethical frameworks, right? But dogs are. And I'm just curious as to whether this is something that you think about when you're working with them, or whether it's just whether you think they should be considered within ethical frameworks. I guess that's a question for everybody. And I guess one comment that I would say is that one of the sort of common themes from all the talks we've had today already is that we're universalizing human. And I think when we say we should be really clear that we're talking about a particular cultural moment in time that relies on the exploitation of other organisms. And so to say that there are organisms becoming extinct all the time and nobody says anything is not actually true. So I just wanted to make that point.
The ethics part, I was not even considering fungi or bacteria to get them into the ethics question, but since I started working with Sasha and her views on ethics about other beings, I am more conscious of it now. So of course, as a scientist, as a biotechnologist, I kill millions and billions and trillions of bacteria every day. So it's maybe just added to my burden of existence. but you are right. We should be not causing too much harm. I'm not going to cultivate them and just destroy them just to destroy them. So if they are useful, then yes, but it's like vegetables, I hope.
We also have to grow and to survive. It's meaning we have to eat something, and we have to wear something. We have to live somewhere. So I would say the world we live now is much better than 1,000 years ago, where we just had let's say that those who are sitting here in the room, they feel much better than the ones 1,000 years ago, which didn't have any heating.
But we're not just talking about 1,000 years ago. There are people on the planet in Berlin right now who don't have the privileges that we have.
This is true, but this has nothing to do with the use and application of microorganisms. So this is a general problem of society.
Of course it does. Penicillin enabled certain parts of the population to survive, and others not. So you can never disentangle these things from the culture that we're living in, right? Or the economies that we're living in.
Yes.
So I don't have an answer to my own question. It's something that I struggle with all the time, is do we consider the ethics of these? I mean, I kill them all the time and I'm brushing my teeth, right?
Yeah, you also kill plants if you eat a tomato.
Absolutely.
Or whatever, and you eat the DNA of the tomato. So it's I mean, of course, perhaps the earth would live better without mankind. Could be.
Yeah.
But then there's no way of having no burden.
But I think
you're
also relativizing what I'm saying. Because
yeah.
I'm not saying that we need to get rid of everything. I'm just saying maybe we. Maybe not yet, right. I'm just saying that maybe we need to, instead of saying all mankind, we need to just think about, okay, there are people who are consuming enormous quantities of food and clothing and housing at the expense of lots of other different organisms. And so we need to be more particular, I think, about the language that we use and the who gets to decide what as well. That, you know, your comment about we are policing ourselves, but clearly in some circumstances that works and in a lot of others it doesn't.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. So, of course, we usually, a couple of times I think I mentioned we are scientists, so I met my community. But you're right, okay, that there is no we, or just we is, again, small sub-communities, and they all have different views on things.
Just like to add this, that like since I started working with living systems, I always like was thinking about this: how are we working with them? What are we doing to them? And actually, I would love to put them on ethics board because I think through that we'd get more answers. Because whatever questions I posed, there are not enough answers because we don't know enough. So there would be, like, really, we would need a lot more research done to know what we're actually doing.
And that potentially would stop research, right?
Mm.
Because if you...
We
can experiment on plants now, for example, do whatever we like to plants, but we can't do whatever we like to other creatures, some other creatures. It's, yeah.
I would like to address the question of economics, since you addressed the idea of an alternative economy in relation to the production of fungi in bioeconomics. And of course, this is a large question, and I draw like my thought and my question from the field of bio econophysics, who is a branch that tries to include in financial theory also the laws of physics. And there was a small booklet where they outlined the question if actually biology could offer alternative concepts for financial and economic concepts. I'm not an expert in that, but I would like to point out that for me in your talk there was an interesting tension between, on one hand, describing the potential of 5 million euros in the production through fungi as working horse in laboratories, and on the other hand, the search and potential of an alternative thinking of economics. And for me, thinking, or the little knowledge that I have on fungi and plants in terms of economic production, it would be interesting for me to know a little bit more if you can tell me what you mean with the term alternative economics through fungi.
So basically, bioeconomy tries to use waste products, which are coming from the wood industry, from the crop industry, so the bagasse, the straw, all these things, and you need, because bacteria and yeast cannot grow on these, and these are also producers of insulin or other drugs. You first need fungi, which degrade the lignin and the cellulose of these plant waste products.
they make glucose out of it, and the glucose is then used to feed the microorganisms, which then produce the bioethanol or the insulin. One step further, you could put cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria fix the carbon dioxide in the air, grow a divide, produce a lot of biomass. Fungi, again, can grow on this biomass and produce whatever kind of products. You can basically, for each and every industry nowadays, we have already, we know that we can replace the classical fossil-based chemicals with products which are produced by bacteria or fungi. The question is how we make a circle out of this so that we provide that there is enough waste material, and basically the solution for Brandenburg might be different than for Bavaria, because here grow other plants than in Bavaria. So this is a kind of decentralized view also of economy, local regional economy. And we still need to do a lot of research to understand, to improve the growth of the fungi on these waste products, and that they grow faster and produce whatever compounds. I don't know whether this does not make sense, but the idea within the last 150 years, mankind always almost managed to release all the carbon which was stored in the soil, so the coal and the fuel. Just almost out. Now we have to find smaller ways how we fix the carbon side, the carbon dioxide, which of course is also released because we are breathing, because the animals we are, the livestock are breathing, everything is producing carbon dioxide. During fermentation, carbon dioxide results. Bioeconomy is a vision of many governments worldwide, to get away from this fossil fuel. And for most, as I said, for most of the plastic, for the fuel industry, you can replace the kerosene with biokerosene. This comes from yeast. You can replace the ethanol, with the bioethanol, also from yeast. But before you can cultivate yeast, you need a fungus, a filamentous fungus, that degrades the plant biomass, because yeast cannot do this. And this led me to say fungi are champions. They can degrade everything and they can produce everything. I'm not aware of any other species or group of organisms who have such a versatile metabolism. So let's use this.
Right, well, I think we're out of time. So thank you again, Sasha and Miriam. Mm-hmm. That's a very excellent panel. I think we have a